I grow mushrooms on logs, I grow mushrooms on stumps, I grow mushrooms on straw, coffee grounds, pretty much anything I can experiment with and get my hands on, I try to grow mushrooms on. But let me just give a very short kind of synopsis of what a mushroom is. Does anyone know what a mushroom is, really? Well, what is a mushroom itself?
Fungus.
A fungus? Well, what does a mushroom do? Just a mushroom.
It eats everything.
Well, a mushroom itself just doesn't.
It sends off spores.
It sends off spores. So, this is the lion's mane. This is a mushroom that grows on beech trees in our native forest. It is a mushroom. The mycelium is going on inside. The mycelium is the hidden world that does all the work. The mycelium is 95% of the life of the mushroom. So the mushroom really is just like a flower. The mushroom gives off its little flower, and then when it's full grown enough, it throws out its spores. And spores actually have the ability to divide and propagate themselves through asexual means. So you don't need a male and a female spore, you just need the right conditions so that those spores can divide and expand themselves. So logs and stumps are great sources for long-term inoculation. You can, from a hardwood log or stump, you can get mushrooms fruiting for as long as 4 to, say, 12 years. I like to use logs that are anywhere from 4 to 14 inches in diameter, freshly cut hardwood. Freshly cut in, say, the very best time of year to do it is from, say, end of September through early May to get your logs. That's the very best. Because the sugars are in the tree as opposed to being out in the leaf or in the bottom of the root system. So the more sugars means that there's more available nutrients for the mycelium to eat. It will work this time of year, but there's not quite as many sugars for the mycelium to jump off onto. And it is best to actually use wood that is fresh. Old wood has probably, for the most part, been downed by something else. Most likely even been downed by a mycelium. You know, there may be mushrooms that are actually eating, mycelia already eating that tree. So if we're going to spend money buying spawn from somebody, you're probably best to put it into something that you're going to have a higher degree of success with. As opposed to, you know, an old log that pretty much has been denuded of most of its nutrients by any of the 3,500 different species of mushrooms that grow in our forest. So, and the standard stump does not take that much time to get broken down by mycelium. An average stump will be broken down in 6 to 7 years, which isn't that long time, you know, and to spend, you know, multiple thousand dollars to bring in a stumper and actually stump down your stumps in your forest. And then haul out all that, still that rest of that tree, and then maybe pull up the root system, can kind of do more damage to your forest than good. So you think about your stumps. You can inoculate your stumps, and you can even keep your stumps high, because the higher the stumps are, the more nutrients there is for the mycelium to feed off. And you think a tree was once, you know, 50, 40, 50, 100 feet tall, you know, 30, 40 foot crown, you also have a 20 to 30 to 40 foot crown underneath the soil. So there's all that nutrient stream for the mycelium to actually travel into and actually get a nutrient source and get a future fruiting body from, which is really great. Now you can inoculate any size stump, you know, because you've got it. It's a big stump. It might take a little bit longer. And nothing, there'll be no source that will give you as long-term fruiting as a big, big stump will. There's pictures of people who have found hen of the woods on stumps now for 40 or 50 years. You know, big, big oak stumps. So it just It's a great source for a long-term crop in your forest. And it is good to have your stumps and logs in a somewhat shady place. Otherwise, the byproduct is drying out. And that's generally the thing that fails with mushroom farmers or people who are trying to grow mushrooms in their gardens or in their woods, is they let stuff dry out. Don't take your log and suspend it from a tree. I've had definitely some folks that thought that was a really cool thing to do. But, you know, it rains and then it leaches all off the log, and then the wind comes and dries out the log. You want to be in a shady, kind of grown-in area, you know, maybe on the edge. Bright, direct sun is not the best place to actually have your mycelium or your mushroom logs. Mushrooms are creatures of speckled light. Generally, they like speckled light. And if they don't like speckled light, they're, like I said, they're heliotropes, and they grow up very fast, and then they senesce. So I like to focus on wood-loving mushrooms, because we have a lot of wood here in New England. So I focus on stuff like the oyster mushrooms. This is called the elm oyster, the Hepzygus ulmarius. And this is a really pretty mushroom for actually growing on hardwood logs. We'll grow on elm, we'll grow on ash, we'll grow on beech, we'll grow on maple. Really fast decomposer. Breaks things down quite quickly. And also is a candidate for, now in nature, this is a pure saprophyte, and saprophytical mushrooms actually go in and break down dead or decomposing material, but isn't necessarily the reason why the material is dead or already beginning to be decomposing. So this is not a parasite. This is not a parasitical mushroom. This will not go in and actually attack a living tree to bring it down. Certain mushrooms will, like the honey mushroom, the chaga, the chicken of the woods. They are naturally parasitical mushrooms. So they may not be the best candidate to actually want to encourage in the forest. I don't make up much spawn for the parasites. I feel like there's a lot of common parasites out there in our woods. So I want to encourage the saprophytes and I want to encourage the mycorrhizals. I might not want to encourage the parasites because I kind of like my oak trees and they will bring down oaks. Sometimes I have had people that really want me to grow some chicken in the woods and I will grow it out for them, but they generally don't have it for sale in courses like this. Doesn't seem to be as popular. And some of these mushrooms that are parasitical, really when they fruit, can fruit in just huge numbers in weight-wise. I mean, the average chicken of the woods when it's fruiting could be 50 to 100 pounds in its size. It's just a huge mushroom. And the chicken of the woods is also a biennial. So it fruits every other year. But you think that a mushroom that is going to grow to be a 50 to 100 pound worth of mushroom, that's a lot of time that it may have needed to accumulate, bioaccumulate the nutrients in order to fruit a big, big mushroom like that. So it's really pretty cool. This is another mushroom. This is a reishi mushroom. This is the Ganoderma lucidium. This is actually a reishi that grows on hardwoods. In our northern forest alone, we have the Ganoderma suge that grows on hemlock trees. This is starting to move up this way. This is the Ganoderma suge. This grows on hemlocks. And this is starting to come out right now in our forest. This is a baby.
Is that red when it...
Yes. Yeah, this is what it looks like when it comes up.
What is that?
Right there. This is a young reishi that was coming up. And it's an interesting thing that's happening as well with this, because this is a reishi that was being hypomazized by another reishi. So this is a reishi growing on a reishi, which is really pretty interesting. itself. So mushrooms will not only eat the wood and the surroundings, but they'll eat each other. And in some cases, certain mushrooms will hypomatize other mushrooms, and you'll get a mushroom like the lobster mushroom coming. Has anyone heard of the lobster mushroom? Yeah, the lobster mushroom is a species that actually is a pure mycelium that has no form without a host. It's like a shapeshifter. It goes in, attacks another living mushroom, and turns it into it. So the lactarius that it often looks like is brown. But once it gets hypomatized by the mycelia of the lobster, it turns orange. Now, almost any mushroom can be hypomatized. So that's why you'd kind of want to be a little bit careful when you're actually harvesting what you think might be lobster mushrooms. You want to make sure you look at the mushroom and kind of think about what it is. See if it has that shape. Because there has been some reported cases of some amanitas being hypomatized and turned into lobsters. But they're a poisonous lobster. So you do kind of have to be a little bit careful out there. Well, these were right out of the mill within like probably a month or two.
Yeah.
But when I inoculate my chips, I try to get them to be about 50% moisture ratio so that there's enough moisture in there so that I can get the mycelium really spreading. But I'm kind of doing something a little different than, say, your average, gardener. You know, I'm growing mushrooms in bags of mycelium to actually get a fruiting source or to get a pure culture so that I can sell it to gardeners or farmers to actually encourage mycelial growth in their gardens or in their plants or growing mushrooms on straw in some way like that. And then there's also the mycorrhizals who actually have an endo or an ecto mycorrhizal property that live in harmony with plants and trees and the environment that they're in. But they are actually the hardest mushrooms to propagate and expand. But because mushrooms are basically just deliverers of spores, we would like to see if we can create an environment that is nice and ready for that environment to be expanded into. And a very simple, very inexpensive way to do this whole expansion and propagation of mycelium and or spores is to do what they call the spore bath inoculation method. So I can take a bucket, fill it half full of water, fill it right up. I can then take a shiitake mushroom, throw it in my bucket with some lukewarm water and some sort of sweetener, like molasses, caro syrup, burnt maple syrup, bunk honey that's not that great, some sort of sweetener that's not really that expensive for purposes of trying to make something like this. So the mushroom in this spore bath is exposed to all these sugars. So this mushroom now has sugars. The mushroom's whole purpose is to send out its spores for asexual reproduction, and the spores in this bath are released, and then you get a frenzy of reproduction going on, asexual reproduction. And this reproduction is happening all inside this bucket. So say now I have shiitake, I have some fresh cut logs, I can make a couple chainsaw cuts in them maybe, and maybe I just broadcast this bucket of shiitake spore bath over the logs, and maybe there's a chance I get some mushrooms fruiting. On the other side, maybe I don't have shiitakes, maybe I'm not looking for a saprophyte, maybe I'm looking to see if I can get chanterelles, or boletes, like the king oyster, the king bolete, or maybe morels, or maybe hedgehog or something else, some other mycorrhizal species. Maybe I want to try to get them growing in a patch in the woods. Maybe I want to see if I can expand a patch. maybe I want to see if I can get chanterelles growing in my garden. I had a guy from on a course I taught last weekend who is from Latvia, and he actually did this in his garden in Latvia and got chanterelles growing in his garden. But he said in Latvia, chanterelles are everywhere. So there's probably a good environment for that mycorrhizal nature going on in his part of the world. I can't guarantee that chanterelles will grow in everybody's garden, but if you have the right matrix in your garden, you may be able to get those growing. And this is really one of the only really tried and true ways of getting successful mycorrhizal mushrooms fruiting from a spore bath. There hasn't been a lot of people that have actually had a lot of success with growing mushrooms of the mycorrhizal nature from just the mycelium of the mycorrhizal species.
Do you let that sit for 24 hours?
Let it sit for 24 hours. Now, once it sits for 24 hours, I can either broadcast it out in the environment that we want it to be broadcast in, or I can actually magnify this on a term of 10. I can make 10 more buckets. Because now this thing is filled with spore, bath, slurry, of all that asexual reproduction going on. And by passing it into more sugars, I can, it's like a starter. It will keep on exponentially expanding itself.
It turns over that quickly?
That's incredible. Well, a mushroom spore will be released in one day. You know, if you do a spore print,
yeah,
you cover it up. Sometimes a spore print will happen within, like the garden giant spore print will explode and be off within an hour or two of you picking it and putting it on a spore print.
It would develop in that aqueous solution and burst in that?
Yeah, it will keep on expanding and bursting. Wow. So this is a cool way where, you know, say I don't want to spend money on getting spawn. And it's a time of year where there's a lot of mushrooms out in the woods, and I know where some chanterelles are, and I know where some inky caps might be, and then I know where some shaggy manes are. Every once in a while, I can just make a little spore bath and just broadcast it out to my garden, because I know I'm bringing in mycelia that isn't parasitical, has mycorrhizal properties, and is most likely going to help your plants. Because in nature, the things that help and feed plants are mycelium. You know, there's not a lot of green sand solution and 5-10-5 out there, and you know, nature is doing that. And plants seem to do pretty darn good in the forest most of the time. So by using Mother Nature's approach to gardening, by using mycelium, by using spore bath, by using the decompositional process, we're constantly building our soils instead of adding amendments that sometimes can be very shallow to the system, very expensive to use, and sometimes can fool plants into being shallow rooted.
How much honey or sweetener would you use?
Like 2 cups.
Okay.
1 cup. Half a cup.
Not much.
The more you put in, the quicker it's probably going to get going.
Okay.
Yeah. But the model is I've seen is about 2 cups for a 5-gallon bucket. And if you use a little tiny bit of slight lukewarm water, the better. Yeah. Okay, so this is our first experiment of the day. We're going to make inoculated straw so that everybody can go home, try to fruit some of their own mushrooms at their house, and then take some of this inoculated straw and then be able to put it out after a couple of fruitings in their garden. How's that sound?
Sounds
pretty cool. Okay, so we got some straw here. Okay, so this is a pretty big barrel. This is a 55-gallon drum. And straw is one of these substrates that is kind of pure in itself. It doesn't have a whole heck of a lot of molds and mildews and stuff that are kind of in it, unless it's kind of been in a really wet source. And this straw that we got here looks pretty good. So it doesn't need a lot to kind of wipe out some of the microorganisms that are going to be in competition when we're trying to get fast fruitings of things. When people are trying to get fast fruitings of mushrooms, they want to try to limit and mitigate the amount of competition that is actually with the substrate. And you can see, there's not a lot of mold, and that's the great thing about straw, is straw doesn't really get moldy that fast. Grass, is the cellular structure is a lot more crushed, whereas straw is a lot more molecularly open. And so the mycelia can grow into it very quickly, and actually it's a very readily available nutrient source that doesn't have a lot of competition. So one of the easy ways to actually inoculate straw is to do direct inoculation in your garden, where you wouldn't actually have to do anything. You could actually just put down straw and then just do a spore bath slurry on top of it of some stuff and see what happens. You don't even have to put a mycelium in there if you don't want to. Mother Nature is going to put one in for you. But if we want to know what we might be eating and consuming, it's kind of best to go in that direction of planting elm oyster or Stropharia or the bluet or some other sort of mushroom like that. But we're looking for a dual approach here. We want to try to get fruitings of mushrooms in our house, and then we're actually going to take the straw after we get a couple fruitings and bring it out to the garden. So when you try to actually grow mushrooms in a closed environment, in a house, in a basement, in a greenhouse, a grow house, we want to actually kind of be ahead of the competition a little bit. And to get ahead of the competition with something like straw, we do what they call pasteurizing. And the pasteurizing would be, for example, like this. We take a 55-gallon drum, we bring it to a boil, we bring it to about 160, between 160 and 180 degrees, and then we turn it right down so that we just keep a nice, consistent temperature, but we don't need to keep the boil going on, because that's enough. We don't want to keep the rolling boil and have it be too hot, because at the higher end of the spectrum of heat, there are some bacteria and molds who actually like temperatures above 200 degrees. So that's where they have found through time and error that between 160 and 180 is a real good source to do this. You could do it with a smaller vessel. You could use it with like a lobster pot. And I've been looking on the web and been wanting to do it for a few years. Haven't done it yet. But there's even people out there that have done solar steamers using the sun to actually pasteurize. You can also use a restaurant steamer to pasteurize. And I've even seen people out there who actually will take a drum, invert it, and they'll use a clothing steamer to do the same process. But for what we're doing here, we're going to use just a bag. And I actually like to use burlap bags because I don't lose a lot of the straw in the barrel. If you use like a wire mesh sack, you seem to lose a lot of straw in the barrel. And I always am having a tough time with the wire mesh sack because sometimes I use some lime in there to retard a little bit of bacteria and mold. I find that the lime over time, because it's a little bit caustic, actually begins to rust and break down the wire. So, burlap bag, it's got a short life, and afterwards I could actually put it in my garden and let the mushrooms break it down. So, if I can get a couple helpers to stuff this bag as full of straw as possible. We use a shredder here, because the shredding of the straw makes it that much more readily available for the nutrient, for the mycelia to get in and start breaking it down quite quickly. Jam it right in there. You can use your foot. Pack it. Get that thing. We got a lot of people here that want mushrooms.
Dave, what did you say again is in that tank right there?
Blood. It's just water. Water and 2 cups of lime. Yep. You don't have to use the lime. I like to use a little bit of lime. It just helps to retire a little bit of the it helps to retire a little bacteria and mold.
Okay.
Rye straw.
You could use rye straw, you could use oat straw, you can use wheat straw, you can use any straw you want.
Okay, and if there's a lot of seed heads on the rye straw, that would
That's
kill
okay.
it. It'll kill
it. It will
yeah.
kill it.
All right.
It will kill it. Yep. Now we wait like 45 minutes, an hour, and then I have that nice little kiddie pool there. My kids are going to be real mad. We're going to probably put holes in it today, I bet. I always take the ones that are a little bit kind of roughed up a little bit. But then we just take like just a nice thing that we can clean out a little bit. You know, like a kiddie pool, we can just kind of wash out a little warm water. Like a place like this has a warm stream of water, so it really works great. And we just let it cool, and then we inoculate them, and then you get to take them home and get to try the fruits and mushrooms. Sounds cool.
Is that fresh enough for your taste?
Okay,
we're on it.
This probably wouldn't be quite fresh enough. But this is for show and tell purposes. I would like it to be, and also I can almost look at that right off the bat by seeing, okay, look at all the mushroom growth already. There's something already going on here, you know. So I know I'm immediately going into competition.
Okay.
So I would fall the tree. I generally wait a week or two. I generally wait a week or two for the natural fungicides in the wood to actually leach out. Because all trees, all plants have mycorrhizal properties within them, but they also have to have some antifungal properties. Because if they don't, then almost all trees would actually have some other sort of mycelium inside of them. So once I down the tree, I like to keep my stumps tall. This is a prime one right here. This is a nice, good-sized stump right here. And I actually am going to look at what mushrooms I have. This is a birch tree. It's considered to be a softer hardwood. It's going to fruit a little bit faster, but won't fruit as long as, say, oak or hop hornbeam or some of the harder rock maple, some of the harder woods. So once it's downed, I actually then want to go to the outermost cambium layer, the outermost inch, and actually inoculate this realm right here. So I'll take my battery drill right here. I can go on the side if I like.
Okay.
Yep. But this is always the best layer to get, because this is the natural direction of where water and sugars and minerals flow throughout a log, is up and down. So I'm covering quite a bit of surface area by just doing this. And I have to remember, the more holes I make in a tree, the more chance there is for other things to go in and come after the mycelium or dry out the log. And the drying out is the enemy of the mushroom hunter, because a log that's dried out doesn't have a lot of liquid for the mycelium to, say, eat.
So if it dries out, does the mycelium die, or does it just go dormant?
Well, it might go dormant, and if it doesn't have the ability to rehydrate itself, it might die.
Yeah. Do you use that same two-week rule when you're using smaller diameter?
I do. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I have this feeling, especially when it comes to stumps in the forest, I'm not afraid to inoculate a stump right away, because that stump is going to be there for a long, long time. And no matter what I do, the other mycelium in the forest are going to rain in on it. So I don't feel bad about inoculating a stump right away. I generally wait, but, you know, these plugs are dense, they're hard, and they're not going to go anywhere. Some people use wood chips, just plain wood sawdust spawn, and it seems to be that doesn't quite last as long. And these are rugged, they're hard, they're filled with mycelium, And even after the two-week span, it may still be doing battle with the antifungal properties, but this still has fungus in it. So,
Dave, how'd you make the plug?
You know, it's really hard. I sit there with a drill, and I like one at a time. And I take a little chisel, and I move them in and out of these little things. I make these little dowels. It takes me forever. I make 30,000 at a time. It takes me like, no, I get them from Maine. Yeah, no. There's no way. There's no way. This is an industrial plug, but it's birch, so it's organic. So I take the plug, just bang her in, just like that.
If you're going on the side of the log, Dave, do the same thing.
Yep,
Do you have to be angled in any way, or just straight in?
Exactly 45. No, there's not a lot of precision, and the amount is really an experiment. I love gardening because it's all experiment, you know. It's like everybody has their tried and true ways, and some work better than others. You know, the more you put in, the more, you know, the faster colonization you might get, but you also might put so many holes in that it's like Swiss cheese, and that the log tends to dry out because you put so many darn holes in there. So you know, I say a stump would take, you know, 20 or so plugs, a good sized stump.
I explained it, but these plugs are drilled out of already inoculated birch?
No, they're not. I inoculate them. Uh-huh. Yep.
You just buy the hollow plug itself.
I buy the hollow plug from the... Well, it's not a hollow plug. It's... These are from the furniture industry. These are spiral grooved dowels that as you push them in, the glue would go into the dowel and help to bond that way. We're actually supposedly, we're one of the only places in the country that actually uses spiral grooved dowels. Most other places in the country use fluted dowels. They're just the little stripes. Which they seem to work too for that. I asked the furniture people if there were any price differences, and they said no. So I use these because that's what I've been using. They seem to work just fine. Now this is another tool for inoculating. Once you use this, you'll never go back to using a drill. It's crazy. Now, one thing you have to be sure of, this is a very powerful drill. It spins at 10,000 RPMs. And if you get this thing caught on an angle, and you do not have this arm bar on there, it will whip around so fast and it will break your arm like that. So, put the arm bar on, please. Safety. Safety. Safety is not an accident. This is a specialized bit made for the doweling industry out of Japan. According to some machine shop people, it's a speed bore bit with half the shank. You can, I guess, buy these at certain stores around. I've never seen one. I'm a carpenter. And I've never seen a drill bit go so fast in and out. I do have some friends that have made this cowlet as well. And I've actually set it up so that it actually takes a drill bit too, and it goes almost as fast. Now, when I'm doing a tree in the woods, I also like to girdle the bottom of the stump. If I don't girdle the stump, there are particular trees out in the woods that are ginormously fast stump sprouters. And that stump sprouting is obviously putting out antifungal properties. So that's why I like to girdle my stumps.
And
that's why part of the mushroom growing industry has actually made rope spawn, which basically is a rope, hemp rope, that's been inoculated with mycelium.
Does everybody understand what girdling is in regards to this? It would be cutting out the bark around the base of the tree so the tree couldn't grow past that.
So then you wrap the rope around the part you girdle?
That's right.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And that just is like another point of inoculation.
Right.
Now, say I don't have rope spawn. So say I don't have rope spawn. I could take plugs and put them end to end to each other. I could take inoculated wood chips. I could take inoculated wood chips and put them in there. I could just girdle it and just leave it like that. Yes?
Do you, I might be jumping ahead, but do you cover with beeswax at all?
We're almost there.
Okay.
Now, in this application, some people will put try to put beeswax on a stump. Really hard to do. How come? Lots of liquid there. Stump? Capillary reaction? Lots of liquid? People put paper bags on top of their stumps and do all sorts of other crazy stuff like that? I don't think so. I think it's just easiest to leave maybe a couple of extra little pluggies with my nice source of wood chips that I have there. And then I take a cookie and I call Cookie Monster and I put it right on top. And within a month, you will not be able to take that cookie off.
Wow.
The mycelium will fuse and grab so hard onto that. I just went out yesterday and checked on the stump that I was hoping was fruiting, and I could not pull that stump off, that cookie off the top here.
So where do the mushrooms sprout out from?
Yeah. From the sides, okay. From the top of here, from it pushes through the bark, wow. It will erupt through the bark.
And it'll go up through the cookie.
We'll go up through the cookie, and the cookie will help to keep the moisture in there. Say now I have a bunch of these big stumps, and I've got some downed wood in the forest, and I want to do what they call totem culturing. So I want to take these stumps that are already down, and one of the great ways to actually try to grow lion's mane is actually just to take stumps right here that I have, and this is called totem culture, and you just take a stump, you take some mycelium wood chips, just like that, and then I just take another stump, just put it on top. It's it. Then you really don't have to do a lot. The lion's mane will grow throughout, and then we'll start fruiting from this injection point, and then we'll move in and around. And I've seen people do lots of little cookies. I've seen people do big cookies. It seems like for longevity and for drying out sake, just the bigger totem like this is not as apt to dry out as, say, small little cookies. Sometimes when I do my courses, I will buck up a bunch of little small cookies like that, and we'll inoculate layers of cookies and tie it off in a little plastic bag, so I get these totems of cookies that are all inoculated, so that people then could just go cut a tree and then take one of these cookies, and that's the inoculation method. Just the cookie itself. And then you can get all crazy and creative and even have more fun and like take a chainsaw and make like plunge cuts into your log and make little holes and portals and maybe birdhouse shelves that you could inoculate into the tree. I mean, if you've got mycelium, if you've got wood chips, you can go all sorts of crazy. Another
so
log rafting then would be the reverse of this. And I would take logs, could be in any length. I had a gentleman down in Hancock who's doing log rafting of, he's crazy, but he had veneer grade oak that the lumberer cut the logs a little short. And the guy didn't want the wood. The mill didn't want the wood. And this guy loves hen of the woods. So he took 6 foot bucks of this veneer grade oaks that were like this big. And he did giant log rafts of hen of the woods. So basically what you would do is you rake out a little place in the forest, maybe lay down some cardboard so that you create what they call a mycelial lens, and kind of like what you saw what the mycelium was doing on that little cardboard, it becomes a very quick, immediate mycelial lens. It's like a dominant organism of mycelia on the substrate. So then we take... You don't have to use cardboard if you don't want. I just think it's a very fast way of getting a dominant foothold. Okay, so I've scarified an edge right here. So now we have a little open point right there. Another little open point right here. I can then take maybe the spore bath inoculant, dump it right on there. I've saved all my little wood chips, and I can then just turn these and have them face each other so that the mycelia is right between the two. So now I have all these surface areas where the mycelia, where the mycelia is going to grow into here, but now I have all the surface area here that is uninterrupted bark. So the moisture will stay inside the wood, and when the time is ready, the mycelium will actually form bundlings, and you'll get fruitings of mushrooms from said these particular areas. And so you could do this with whole rafts of wood. There's no size limit. There's no, you know, any size, small, big, however you want. You don't even really have to mar it if you don't want to. But it seems like the slight marring of one little point allows the mycelia to get into the wood quite quickly.
I've got a number, quite a few maples about that size that I cut last year, late last fall.
Yep.
Worth trying to inoculate still?
I would do with oyster. I think oyster might be okay.
Yep. And now would you...
I might do a heavier inoculation than a lighter one.
Right. And would you cut it fresh or just leave it the way it is and inoculate right
stumps?
Yeah.
I'd maybe cut off a little...
I mean,
tiny...
I've got them, you know, they're a foot tall right now.
Right.
So I could take another inch off them or so. And
could be even a, just do a test, light cut, just to see what's going on there. If you see a lot of mycelial growth, maybe you have to go down a little bit more. But, you know, after late last year, there hasn't been a lot of fruiting bodies sporulating.
That's what I was.
So you're probably going to be safer than someone who's going to go after a 2 or 3 year old stump.
Yep.
Yeah. And of course, the harder the wood, the more of a likelihood that there's not a lot in there yet.
Yep.
You know, if it was a birch from last year around this time, there'd probably be a lot more activity going on.
Right. Okay.
Yep.
Do you ever inoculate cherry?
Cherry is one of those woods that works, but isn't a great wood to work.
How about it's sugar maple?
Awesome.
How about aspen?
Good to use, fast to fruit, not a long time for fruiting. About 4 years maximum.
So what are the time frames following inoculation?
The bigger it is, the longer it's going to take. Sure. You know, 20-inch stump, you know, is going to take a little bit of time. You know, a stump generally is going to take about 1 to 2 years. A log, 3 to 4 foot in length, 3 to 4 foot in length, 4 to 14 inches diameter, could be as little as 9 months. And like.
I got a question, man. How are you storing your logs?
I take my logs and I bring them out into a forested area. I put them off the ground on like a pallet, or I take some freshly cut logs and put them on rocks, at least just so they're off the ground. And then I build like little log cabins, little log cabin style. So I do what they call the spawn run. That's the spawn run, where you let it sit for 6 to 9 months. And then after that 6 or 9 months comes, if it's not in the middle of winter time, I'll try to do what they call a forced fruiting. And in mushroom log culturing, or inoculating, there's kind of two approaches. One's called the benign neglect, laissez-faire, and that is just kind of, you just kind of make a stump culture like this, and you just leave it. You don't do anything else with it. Now, with benign neglect log, once I go through the spawn run for about 6 to 9 months, I then take my log, and if it's like shiitake or oyster or say lion's mane, I will bury the log vertically in the ground by like a quarter of its mass, and I'll leave it there for the rest of time. And I'll let Mother Nature fruit it. Now, I'm most likely to get somewhat 2 to maybe 3 fruitings a year from those particular logs. Now, if I want to go to do what they call the forced fruiting method, I would like to dunk my logs in water, completely submerge them, like the spore bath inoculation method, completely submerge them for 24 hours, and then I'll put them back, and I'll stand them vertically, kind of on a pallet or on a rock, or have them set up in the woods, off the ground, for, say, 2 weeks. And the 2 week time is generally what they will fruit within of the dunking time. And the dunking basically simulates a flood or a catastrophe. And mushrooms are creatures of catastrophe. They love big, big meteorological events. They say after Hurricane Katrina and after the big flooding rains that we had last year from the hurricane, it was amazing how many mushrooms were around. Well, mushrooms are creatures of liquid and water, and when they have lots of moisture and lots to eat, there's a lot that can go on. So this is the forced fruiting or the benign neglect. My major enemy is other contaminated mushrooms. So if I put all my mushrooms on the ground in the wood, I'm most likely to go up like we did here and peel them over and see mycelial threads already trying to come up here. You're going to get some activity going on, even off the ground, but what I'm trying to get is I'm trying to get my mycelium to be the head competition, to be the one that's the victor in the end. I've heard of people doing inside their greenhouses, taking these logs and putting them all underneath their beds. So there's a constant source of water dripping on them. They're still in good shade, and there isn't as much going on in a greenhouse as, say, in the middle of the forest floor. Could do something like that. Don't take your logs and bring them into your shower. Yeah. I always stand my logs to fruit them, unless I'm doing hen of the woods or, say, reishi. Hen of the woods, I always lay down horizontally. But both of those species are ones that really much rather have benign neglect than forced fruiting. The forced fruiting are best with shiitakes and oysters and beech and bricktop mushrooms and chestnut. The lion's mane is much better totem or species that's in the ground benign neglect style. That is awesome! I need a proud point on my yurt. So I'm going to take a small amount on the bottom, just about like that, okay? I'm going to take a little bit of this oyster spawn right here. Sprinkle it right in here.
Just a handful, right?
Just a handful, yep. And then I want to put a little bit more in there. Take my bag. Mix it up. And then maybe I'll take a little bit more. Just one other small handful. Mix that in. Put another a couple little pockets like that. So we want to get it like about kind of like about half full, and then we want to just kind of squeeze the air out of it so it's nice and tight like this, like that, and then we just want to spin it around.
Above the sugar.
Tie it off, just like that. And then I have some duct tape where you can just label it elm oyster or cajou oyster, one or the other. That was elm oyster. When you get home, you want to take your bag and put like 10 holes around the outside of the bag. And when you get home, you can either put it in your basement or a closet or in a nice place where there's somewhat consistent temperatures. And you want to, you can either hang it, or you could put it on a brick, or put it on a piece of like a trivet, or a wire rack, or something. But you just don't want this sitting directly on the concrete floor, or on a surface that's going to allow there to be a mold pocket in this moist environment to be there. So you can hang, put it on a brick, put it in a greenhouse, put it underneath your bench, under something. Something like that. And then what you'll see, within probably a day or two, you'll start to see the white mycelium spreading throughout the bag. And then all of a sudden, one day you'll either see a little mushroom thing popping up like that little elm oyster over there, or you'll see bundling happening on the side of the bag. And if you see some of this bundling, which is just kind of like, it almost looks like a baby mushroom to be, pop a little hole right where the bundling is. And then it will come out that spot. Once you see the bundling start to happen, start misting the bag. Give a little bit of a misting. Yeah, you could fruit this 2 to 3 times, sometimes even more. And then you can take this and mix it into your garden. Or you could take a couple bales of straw and take this and sandwiches in the middle. And see if the mycelium will spread throughout the whole entire thing of straw. You could mix it into wood chips. You could try to do a little experiment on a stump with some other straw. Okay. See what happens.
So will we get a pound of mushrooms or a half pound of mushrooms?
It's hard to know exactly how much you'll get.
Okay.
You know, it depends upon what your temperature is, whether you put it into a place where there's a high mold content, whether you don't pay attention and they come in fruit, you don't miss them, give them a little bit of extra moisture. Better to have them in a place that has some humidity in it versus like a dry attic.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, most likely, most people get a pound or two.
Okay.
Once they fruit, you probably want to cut them. You don't want to let them get all sporulating all over the place.
Yeah.
So this one had a kind of a natural wound pocket here. So I went in my chainsaw and made it a little bit bigger and stuffed in a bunch of elm oyster spawn into this pocket. And we had a fruiting of elm oyster here. Might even have one again coming up soon. So we packed it in full wood chip spawn so the mycelium would start moving and start spreading throughout the tree. And then just for a little experiment showing people what the other approaches you can do with it, is I took my chainsaw and made a little cut so that I made a little wedge pocket, and then I inoculated wood chip spawn into this area right here, and so that it would be another place where it was actually getting into the tree. And it was just the bark that pulled off a little bit, but the wood is pretty much stuck, and there's no nail or screw or anything holding in it. It's just the mycelium is holding on to it. And that's just a way you can, kind of another way, instead of drilling, you can just use the wood chip spawn. Or say, we just made that sort of pocket and we had the spore bath inoculant, we could just kind of broadcast it out into this particular area and see if maybe that would happen. Maybe we do a pile of wood chip spawn that we inoculate and then we do it that way afterwards. Maybe try an experiment, and maybe somebody's got some of the straw culture that's fruited a couple times, and maybe
stuff a little bit of mushroom straw in there. That could work too. You know, any source that the mycelia will spread out into, you know, would be a great substrate host.
Well, we also got that oak down the way. There's another oak stump down the way. So let's take a walk down this way.
Okay, big chunk. But you can see the mycelium right here.
When was that then?
Last year? See, that's a big stump right here. So this certainly might take a little bit of time. But yeah, I do see the mycelium already here. I see the rope spawn. I don't see a lot of stump sprouting, so that's a good thing. I see a lot of mycelium still inside these little plugs. So yeah, this puppy might be a couple years for this thing, because it is big. It's got a lot of mass. There's a lot to it.
Right, and the mushrooms have to feel like they don't have room before they fruit, right?
Oh yeah, I can see what you mean. A lot of these have just been...
Oh, pulled out? This is the one you're going to...
But yeah, you can see there's tons of mycelium inside these pockets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah? Look at that. If everyone comes and they can just take a peek right inside these pockets, you can see the mycelia is in there.
Oh, yeah.
What is that?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
When they finally fruit, it's because they feel like they don't have room. Right?
They finally fruit because they feel limited to the amount of nutrients that there is. So in a place like this, there's a lot of nutrients for them. So it might be a little bit longer for a stump of this size to fruit, as opposed to something like this small birch tree here.
So you might be better off like inoculating a bunch of small.
So it's all depending upon what you're trying to achieve.
Right.
If you're,
and then you also have some stuff for sale.
I do have some fresh mushrooms. There's a few books, and there's all that spawn. If anyone wants any spawn,
so the spawn you could use right off in your straw and your
straw wood chips.
Or do you have some plugs as well?
Got plugs as well. Okay. And if people wanted to on the way back, there was a little spot last year that I put some strawberry in, and I can see it and smell it, and it looks like it probably will fruit and be doing pretty good.
Is strawberry the only one that will fruit in an open sunny spot in a bunker?
No, the strawberry will fruit like that. The parasol mushroom will, and so will the almond portobello.
Okay.
It will fruit in that speckled light.
Okay. Just to ask offhand, those bags of stuff you got, how much does one of those typically go for?
The smaller ones, the little ones are a little bit smaller, 25, and the ones that are full size are 30.
Okay, and then, if I did everything right, what would be the possible yields off something like that?
Well, you know, it could be, you know, if you did like a big, huge bunker spawn pile. I mean, it could be, you know, 100 some odd pounds of strafaria.
Yeah.
You know, if you just did like small individual beds, that's where it could be just like, you know, 2-3 pounds. But you could keep on expanding them like Steve was saying, and you create a mother patch and you just keep on expanding it from there. I like to make bunker spawn. I like to take a pile of wood chips first thing in the spring and then bring like a elm oyster and strafaria and inoculate the pile and just let it get fully colonized, so then I can make a lot of beds.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of, you know, economy of scale, take one starter and make a bunch of starter.
In terms of economy, once again, you have the plugs versus the sort of loose stuff. And
plugs are really for logs and stumps.
And about how much do they go for a piece?
They're $35 for 500. Yep, so economy of scale, it is a little bit cheaper to use wood chip spawn. But I do find that the wood chip spawn seems to kind of disappear a little faster than the plug spawn does. And especially when it comes to the sawdust spawn, that seems to disappear even faster. But if it's already in the wood, and you know, even though a couple of these plugs have gone out, I still see tons of mycelium here. And the great thing about an oak is that these are so dense and they're so hard that they're going to stay around for a long time, and the mycelium still should be here and should fruit.
Is there a common name for strafaria?
The garden giant or the brandy wine cap.
Yeah. Ah, okay.
Those are the common names. Yeah. The Latin is the strafaria rugosi.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah. Actually found a honey mushroom species out in the Midwest that goes out to the west that is said to cover like 2.3 or like 4 point something million hectares of land. It's considered to be the largest organism on Earth, and it's actually a honey mushroom. It's the amaryllis species. It's related to the honey mushroom that we have in our northern forest here. Quite a tasty mushroom, but it's not really the mushroom that's doing all the work. It's the mycelia. So when we're talking about organism and size, it's the mycelia that is the largest organism, not necessarily the mushroom, since 95% of the life is the mycelium. So, mycelium. How do we work with mycelium? So, we take mycelium and we like to try to encourage its growth in the gardens, in and around our plants, in our compost pile. Why? Why do you think mycelium is good to have in those substrates that we're talking about here? Any ideas?
Decomposes.
Breaks things down. Yeah. Humans seem to be really good at taking soil. A lot of times we dump it or jettison it, but we need to be kind of following Mother Nature's example and actually become better earth makers. And there's a great organism out there called mycelium. It's just about the best earth maker on earth. It actually really has the ability to break just about anything and everything down. They're even doing stuff right now called mycoremediation, and that's cleaning up hazardous waste sites with mycelium. They've been breaking down sarin nerve gas agent. They've been breaking down petrochemicals. They've been working towards trying to break down mercury and lead and breaking down heavy metals. Now, the funny thing about heavy metals is heavy metals are an element, and it's matter. And matter cannot be created nor destroyed. It always is. But what mycelium and mushroom has the power to do is actually certain types of mycelium and mushroom actually have the power to uptake the heavy metals into the actual physical mushroom. And some industries are actually working towards actually trying to heat treat those mushrooms and centrifuge out the heavy metals. So there's a lot of toxins that we've released into the world. And seems to be that's what the mushrooms really do best, is they break things down. And every time there has been like massive catastrophe on Earth, the mushrooms really end up inheriting the earth. Here's another example of mycelium growing. Here is a piece of cardboard, which is a really awesome way to use mushrooms in your garden. Cardboard is kind of an abundant thing in our waste stream. And there's really no other source out there that is as biodegradable and as good for your soils to expand mycelium than to use sheets of cardboard. A lot of people use black plastic or fabric cloth in their gardens, but once you put it in there, it stays in there. And I don't know who you are or what your garden is, but black plastic eventually breaks down a little bit. You get the webs of life of the plants moving through that stream, and you'll always have these wafts of black plastic in your gardens. Or you'll have fiber paper or what they call, you know, fabric cloth. It's supposed to keep the weeds away, but I always see stuff growing through it. So then after the time, you've got this matrix of weeds growing into fabric paper and cloth, and then you have this problem in your garden. Well, cardboard is great for the year. So you kind of work on like a permacultural model of building your soils, and on a year-to-year basis, trying to keep down the weeds with stuff like cardboard, wood chips, straw, hay, compost, all these other things that you can actually build up soils, smother the stuff that you don't want to have going on, and actually continue to get the plants that you want to have there. And that's where mycelium comes in so well, because you can actually incorporate the mycelium into your wood chips to actually break down the wood chips and make a readily available nutrient source for your plants. Yes, sir.
You have to worry about the ink chemical from the cardboard?
Like I tend to use brown or really kind of pure looking cardboard, not lots of colors. I would tend to want to go with maybe a soy based ink. Maybe ask some of the folks from that box company. But a lot of the cardboards do come with a soy based ink, especially if they're a food grade cardboard. But yeah, the more colors and inks and stuff on the cardboard, yeah, there is a chance of some chemical getting into the ground. But you know, you don't necessarily have to use cardboard. You could use newspaper. There's a lot of soy-based ink being used in newspapers as well. So it's really a good source for that as well. So there's lots of mushrooms out there in the kingdoms. And mushrooms come in all different shapes and sizes. This is called the shiitake. This is a shiitake block. This is hardwood, sawdust, and wood chips that you can see on top. And this is a block that I actually inoculate with mycelium to actually get mushrooms growing and fruiting from them. This is an example of that. And I'll bring in a log right here. Now in the granite state that we are here, we do have a lot of trees. And we do have some of the best trees in all the world for actually growing mushrooms on. We have a lot of hardwood species. So this is a shiitake growing, I believe, on a maple. And this is a really great way of taking younger trees that we may not want to use for, say, we might not want to use for logging for doing, stairs or building boards or planks and stuff with. Might be some of the offcuts of the limbs from trees that we might be using when we're cutting down trees for firewoods. Is a great source for long-term inoculation and good to actually have out in our forests for a good food supply, which eventually will break down and become part of the forest again. The cycle of life in the forest is living, death, and regeneration. That's kind of the cycle of your garden, living, death, and regeneration. And the more we can add to our soils, the more we can utilize the wood chips, the leaf trimmings, the twigs, the branches, whole pieces of wood, the better for the future soils for our gardenings and beyond. And this is just one example. This is the shiitake. This is one of the more prized ones for health purposes. It's a really nice mushroom. Has a very unique flavor unto itself. The shiitake tastes like nothing else. And it is a good species that can actually be grown in our northern forest here. Another mushroom right here is called the chestnut mushroom. That's an adiposa species right there. This can be grown on logs, can be grown on stumps, can be grown doing what they call log rafting. And log rafting is basically taking a couple of these logs, laying them down on the forest floor, and putting some mycelium in and in between them. That's called log rafting, where you let the mycelium get in and break your wood down for you. And a lot of times, if you really don't even care what sort of mushroom you're trying to get, you don't even need to do anything. There is so many mushrooms in our forest that our native mycelia will colonize pretty much everything you put out in the forest.
How do you tell the difference between a safe mushroom and a toadstool? That thing you just passed by sure looked like toadstool. I would have judged it as such.
So there's a common word people use, toadstool. That's kind of a common word. But that's just like a blanket for mushroom. People say mushroom, toadstool. They kind of, a lot to most people, the jargon is the same. You have to be careful with mushrooms. You know, you just can't go willy-nilly picking any mushroom you want and eating it, because there's a good chance that you're most likely going to be eating your last mushroom. So it's knowledge. You have to maybe be part of a mushroom club or have a good book that you use. I have a couple good books here. I have a couple. Let's see, I'm grabbing my truck. I've got a couple right here. Come on in.
Oh,
There's a mushroom guide in the Northeast by Alan Bissett and David Fisher. It's an excellent book on mushrooms. This is a better book for bringing out in the field. This is a National Audubon Society Field Guides on Mushroom by Gary Linkoff. This is just another little book about mushrooms, but it's really important that you just don't look at pictures. You know, because you can be fooled, because different mushrooms have different sizes and different shapes at different times. And if you just look at pictures alone, there is a chance that maybe you have cross-referenced one mushroom for another, and then you might end up really sick, or you may end up crossing the River Styx. So, and not on Styx, under the Styx. So, you know, there's over 3,500 different species of mushrooms just in our eastern forest alone. And they say worldwide there could be upwards of some odd million. So there are a lot of different mushrooms out there, but mushrooms are not that hard to categorize. Mushrooms come in all shapes and sizes. For people who don't know, is this a mushroom? Yeah, this is chaga. Doesn't look like a mushroom to the average eye, but like I said, mushrooms come in all different shapes and sizes. There are black mushrooms, there are blue mushrooms, there are pink mushrooms, there are green mushrooms. There are mushrooms with no gills that are polypores. There are mushrooms with gills, like this shiitake. There are mushrooms that have these little teeth, like this. That is the lion's mane. Right up here. That was that big lion's mane I fell off on the way up here. These have little teeth. There are mushrooms that look like little bird's nests. The bird's nest fungus. There are cup fungus. They just look like little cups. So basically, in the family of mushrooms, there's basically three different families. And the most important families to us as gardeners and farmers are the mycorrhizal mushrooms and the saprophytic mushrooms. Well, it is a known fact that every plant on Earth has a naturally occurring mycorrhizal relationship with a mycelium. Now, mycelia actually surround root systems of plants, go through what they call ectomycorrhizae, and there's also mycorrhizae mycelia that actually penetrate into the core of certain plants and live in absolute harmony with them. Has anyone heard of the lady slipper? There's a mycelia that actually lives inside the orchid plant, as with all orchids, and actually live in harmony with the plant and actually help to break things down so that the mycelia then will expend off enzymes and acids that the plant likes to eat. So in nature, mycelia is everywhere. In nature, mushrooms are everywhere. So the health of your environment, your lawns, your gardens, your trees, are associated to good, healthy mycorrhizal habitats. Yes?
We have a 45-acre forest with so few mushrooms. It's like, you know, there's scarcer than hen's teeth. And I just wonder why.
Well, sometimes, as like I was telling you before, sometimes mushrooms are creatures of limits and limitations. And the mushroom only fruits when it feels limited by the amount of nutrients that it has. So you may have a forest that has a lot of regenerative qualities to it. You may have a lot of triticets coming down. You may have a lot of richness to your soils. And you will only get mushrooms popping out when your forest is stressed. Maybe after giant rainstorms. Maybe after really long dry events. You know, different forests have different qualities. Some can be linked to aspect, and exposure, whether you're west exposure or north exposure or south exposure or northeast or northwest, whatever you are, you'll find that the more shady and the more moist a forest is, the more species of mushrooms you'll apt to have in it. So if you have a forest that has like a real western or southern exposure, you're going to have a lot more of what they call heliotropic species. And heliotropic species like full sun. But those species come up and they senesce and disappear very quickly. Okay. What's your forest like?
Well, the forest, part of it was a terrible logger came in and, about 20 years ago and logged out part of it, like 10 acres of it or so, and it's starting to regenerate, but the rest of the forest, the other 30 acres, have been sitting there for probably 100 years.
Really heavy clay soils.
Yeah, and it's heavy clay soil.
And they have lots of deer problems, so they don't have a lot of undergrowth.
Oh, so you have a lot being eaten, consumed by something.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's a succession forest, just like around here.
Yep. Yeah.
We're in the fairways in New York State.
Thick and dense and...
Mm-mm.
Oh, it's all stripped.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's probably partly why there's a lot of convection through the wind. There's a lot of critters moving in. You probably have a lot of mushrooms that pop up, but they may get eaten by stuff.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But a forest like that may be a good forest to actually, to maybe grow mushrooms on logs or stumps, because you might have a lot of small diameter wood coming up.
Oh.
Small diameter wood is the best wood for actually growing mushrooms on, because there's more sapwood than there is heartwood. And sapwood is the very best wood to grow mushrooms on because it's high in sugars. Big, dense heartwood doesn't really have a lot of life going on in there. It's really dense, it's really thick, it's very tight, and there's not a lot of transpiration through the xylem and phylum of liquid going up and down. Pretty much it's like you look at a tree that's hollow inside, and you're like, how the heck is this tree still living? Well, that outer cambium layer still has enough sugars and zonation so that you still get the transpiration of liquids and sugars up into the tree canopy, and then you still get leaves coming out, even though the core of the tree, there's virtually nothing left in it.
Yeah.
It may fall apart, it may disappear eventually, but it's just going to be a matter of time.
Mm-hmm.
But your forest sounds like it needs to continually have the slash brought down. It needs to have regenerative qualities to it. And the modern practice of logging and taking everything out of the forest isn't necessarily wonderful for the health of your forest.
Right.
It may be really cool for a manicured, good-looking forest, as someone would call it, but it's not really great for the long-term health of a forest. Because a forest is just a kind of a regeneration of living, dying, death, and regeneration over and over and over again for millions and millions of years. And what do they say? It's like every 1,000 years of time on the land, you can eventually grow like an inch of soil. That's not very much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's why if we're constantly having silviculture and forestry practices going on, and we're constantly taking out everything from the forest, we're not doing much for the health of the mycorrhizal ecosystem or much of the health of the plants that live there as well.
Right.
And really, the animals are probably suffering too, because they're probably trying to scratch at anything and everything to try to find stuff to eat. Any other thoughts?